Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to tonight's Board of Appeals hearings. Before we begin, let me introduce some members of town government that act as advisors to this board. To my left is Paul Hennings, counsel to the board. To his left is David Flynn, assistant planning director. To his left is Blaise Donadio, a planner in the planning department. Now let me tell you why you're here tonight. New York State statute requires that any town that adopts zoning must also have a Board of Appeals to act as a relief valve so that those persons aggrieved by strict application of the zoning ordinance can seek relief without the expense of going to court. Board can give Board of Appeals additional powers such as special exception approvals, site plan approvals. In Smithtown, the town board has given this board authority regarding certificate of existing use and some special exception uses. The most common kind of application before the board are area variances. Area variances deal with dimensions such as lot area, frontage, height, setback, and parking spaces. New York State statute mandates that the board must consider the following criteria in area variances. When you come to the podium to present your application, you need to address these five areas. They're posted here for you. Number one, whether an undesirable change will be produced in the character of the neighborhood or a detriment to nearby properties will be created. Number two, whether the applicant has other feasible alternatives. Number three, whether the variance is substantial. Number four, whether an adverse impact on the environment will be created. And number five, where the alleged difficulty is self-created. The statute requires the board to balance the interest of the applicant and those of the neighborhood or community. This statute further requires that the board shall grant the minimum variance that's deemed necessary and adequate, and at the same time preserve and protect the character of the neighborhood and the health, safety, and welfare of the community. The board has the power to impose reasonable conditions for granting variance. Special exceptions applications are different than area variances. We have a special exception application before us. I will explain the different criteria for each. Regarding procedure, cases will be called in order that they are advertised. When your case is called, please come forward, submit your affidavits and mailing receipts to Mr. Donadio, and then you will be sworn in at the podium and given the opportunity to explain to the board why you need the variance. After the applicant is done speaking, all interested parties will be given one opportunity and only one opportunity to be heard. So please organize your thoughts, keep your remarks factual that are related to the case. Then I will ask the applicant to come back to the podium to answer your concerns. The board will then close the case and reserve decision. After all the hearings are closed, the board will review the cases and decide some of them. Others will be reviewed at a later date. There are three ways to find out the results of the case. Number one, you can wait until after the public hearing, but there's no guarantee the board will act on your case tonight. Number two, you can call the planning department tomorrow afternoon. And number three, applicants can wait and be notified by mail. We do have some adjournments, so let me go to those. Case 17022, West Development Partners, has been adjourned to July 8th, 2014. Okay. Next case, 17113, Virginia Massaro, has been adjourned to June 10th. Was there anyone interested in those, both, any of those cases?
Mm-hmm. Madam Chair and members of the board, the first case is 17,125. Heidi Cassati, 12 Wood Hollow Lane, Fort Salonga, New York. Location, west side of Wood Hollow Lane, 1,172 feet south of Meadowood Lane, Fort Salonga. Property zoned R43. request variance to reduce minimum front yard setback from 60 feet to 58 feet for a proposed 71-square-foot portico. The letters were sent certified, but not return receipt requested.
I don't know. So you're not, you have no idea if they
have to adjourn it?
Yep.
They'll have, the board will adjourn it to give you a chance to send the letters out, return receipt requested. No, we'll get a letter from the clerk saying that it's adjourned and what date it's adjourned to, and you'll need to send letters out, return receipt requested, at least 14 days prior to that date.
I'll give you the date right now.
But I have to go back and get a new sign, correct?
You could change the date on the sign, but you will need a new affidavit saying that the property is posted again. So yeah, I think you'd
go back to
the planning department, you'll need a new affidavit. And the mailing affidavit will have to be done again also. So two affidavits you'll need. Sorry about that.
If she does it by tomorrow, will there be time?
For the following hearing?
When is the closing date for the next hearing? It's 2 weeks.
It'll be 2 weeks from today.
She doesn't have to re-advertise, right?
There's nothing in the newspaper, no.
No. So if you get everything done, I'll give you the next hearing.
Only if you get it done tomorrow.
Yeah. You got to.
That's tough.
So why not the hearing after?
Okay.
Let's just see what she says.
No. June 10th. Okay.
Okay. So just re-send the letters out, certified, return receipt.
Right. And two affidavits.
Right, re-notarized.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. And just change the date on the sign.
Yeah. June 10th.
Okay.
Okay, the next case is number 17,126. Susan Mahoney, 14 Roxbury Drive, Commack, New York. The location, north side of Roxbury Drive, 231 feet west of Indian Head Road. Property zoned R10. Request variance to reduce minimum rear yard setback from 50 to 46 feet for a proposed 229 square foot first floor addition.
May I have your name, please?
Susan Mahoney.
And your address, Susan?
104 Roxbury Drive, Commack.
Okay. Raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay. Want to tell us why you're here?
Sure. I'm here for a setback variance to reduce the minimum rear yard from 50 feet to 46 feet for a 229 square foot first floor addition with a crawl space. This variance will not change the nature of the neighborhood, being as a lot of the homes on Roxbury Drive do have additions on the rear. Whether they're legal or not, I don't know, but there are several on the street. It's not an excessive setback. I'm only asking for a reduction of 4 feet. And I could achieve it some other way. I would have to probably go up if I wanted to, but if I wanted to go up, I would have bought a two-story house as opposed to a ranch. My backyard is very private. I'm kind of at the low point, so I can't see out of my backyard into anybody else's backyard, and the same is true for the people behind me. There's no impact on the environment. There's no environmentally sensitive lands in the area. I live four houses off Indian Head, so I don't think that's going to affect that in any way. And the difficulty was actually created by, I was the former owner and myself, because I've asked, I'm non-conforming, because I've already asked for two other variance setbacks. One was for a deck, and the other one was for addition that the former owner put on. So it was a self-created difficulty asking for this variance setback. And that's it.
Planning?
No comments.
Gentlemen?
No comments.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Regularly moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carried.
The next case is 17,127. Glenn Riley, 26 Dorfer Lane, Neskonset, New York. The location, southeast corner of McKinley Street and Treadwell Avenue, Neskonset. Property zoned R10.
Thank you.
Request, variance to reduce minimum rear yard setback from 35 feet to 24 feet for an existing 120 square foot second story deck.
May I have your name, please?
Glenn Riley.
And your address?
26 Dorfer Lane.
All right, but this is not the property.
The property is 243 Treadwell Avenue in St. James.
I found out the hard way yesterday.
What?
looking for that. All right. Raise your right hand, please. You swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm here asking for a rear yard setback to reduce from 35 feet to 24 feet. I purchased the property and had renovated it, and the deck already existed, and I had to rebuild it. Subsequently, I am encroaching on the setback at that point. It is a high ranch, and most of the houses in the neighborhood are high ranches, and it's the only way to get out of the backyard by the second story, which is about 7 feet off the ground. Almost all of the houses that are high ranches have this, and I'm conforming with what everybody else has in the neighborhood. And I don't have any wetlands or any environmental issues at that point. I do have a few letters from neighbors that approve of it and don't have any problems with it, and some pictures of houses that have my neighbors that have the same type of deck, if you would like to
see them. Are the pictures labeled? No, I need the, if you wanted the pictures, they have to be labeled. Well, who took the photographs? What's the address?
Okay.
All right? Yeah, good. That's fine. Very good. Okay. Okay. Planning?
No comments.
Gentlemen?
No questions.
Okay. Thank you so much. Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? You want to be heard on it? Okay, then come up to the podium, please. You don't talk left, please. You got to give me your name and spell your last name.
Rosemary Roberts, R-O-B-E-R-T-S.
Okay, and your address?
43 McKinley Street.
Okay.
I live...
Right, raise your right hand first. You swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Now, what would you
I live across the street from the house. I think Glenn did a fantastic job. I don't know if anybody had the opportunity to see the house beforehand.
We were there yesterday.
No, beforehand.
Okay.
With the 15 cats and everything else that was there. It was an eyesore for the whole neighborhood.
He did a wonderful, wonderful job. I don't know what the problem is with the deck.
All right, thank you so much.
Okay.
That was nice, thank you. Anyone else? Okay, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
It's readily moved in second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, motion carried.
The next case is 17,128 Capital One Bank, 245 Lake Avenue, St. James, New York. Location, southeast corner of Lake Avenue and 7th Street, St. James, property zoned CB District. Request variance to increase the maximum area of a ground sign from 32 square feet to 54 square feet, to increase the number of wall signs from 1 to 2, and to increase the height of a wall sign from 15 feet to 18 feet.
Your name, please?
Ricardo Cervini, CERVINI, 229 Smithtown Boulevard, Neskonset, New York.
Okay. Okay, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay.
Capital One's requesting a variance to maintain the existing signs at this location, consisting of one wall sign and one ground sign. Wall sign S2238 is fronting 7th Road. They are requesting approval to permit a second wall sign on the establishment in order to increase the visibility due to the nature and characteristic of the property, increase the height from 15 feet to 18 feet. ground sign S2236 on the corner of Lake Avenue and Woodlawn Avenue. They are requesting to increase the maximum area of a ground sign from 32 square feet to 53.5 square feet, which includes the base calculation. Capital One believes that if the board should approve this application, there will not be any negative impacts to the surrounding properties. Does the board have any questions?
Planning?
Madam Chair, members of the board, just a few pieces of information. As you are aware, this branch of Capital One is located on the corner of Lake Avenue and Woodlawn Avenue. It's a rather heavily traveled intersection with a traffic light. And as you can see in the photographs that are in the file with the application, the ground sign is rather close to the intersection of Lake Avenue and Woodlawn Avenue. To have to increase the size of it from 32 square feet to 54 square feet is not necessary due to any visibility issues, as well as increasing the height from 15 to 18 feet. A 32 square foot sign at 15 feet in height should be more than visible at the corner of that intersection for pedestrians and motorists who are going through that intersection. We certainly don't recommend approval of a 54 square foot sign if it's not needed. However, if the board chooses to, perhaps the height could be brought down to be in compliance with 15 feet rather than 18 feet.
Okay, let me just ask you a question.
Go right ahead.
That 54 square feet.
Yes.
Doesn't that just, that contains, they measured with the.
That's the base.
With
the base. So actually, if you lowered the height of the sign, it would actually reduce the size of the sign as well. Because.
Well, the base calculation is because of the thickness.
Right.
That's what's, it's going beyond the 24 inches. So it has nothing to do with the actual height or square footage. The height is for the wall sign.
I thought there was an increase.
No, it's not for the ground sign, it's for the wall sign.
Okay, my mistake.
Okay.
Okay. Just so you know that these particular ground signs have been approved by this board at different locations.
Let me know. What's the, without the thickness and everything, what's the square footage of that sign?
It looks like 32 square feet, so it's a typical sign.
Okay. Anybody else?
No question.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. Anyone here would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Motion carried.
The next case is 17,129. Celine Cavacchioli, 22 Meadow Road, Kings Park, New York. Location, south side of Meadow Road, 204 feet east of Indian Head Road, Kings Park. Property zoned CB. Request, variance to increase maximum occupancy in rear yard from 25 to 32% for a proposed 1,200 square foot detached garage. Reduce buffer planting along the rear residence district from 10 feet to 0 feet.
Your name, please? And your address?
22 Meadow Road.
Kings Park.
Kings Park.
All right, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay. Would you like this gentleman to speak for you?
Yes, please.
Okay. Good evening, Madam Chairwoman, members of the board. Ralph L. Sasser, New Key Expediting. For the applicant.
Wait a minute, please. Spell your last name.
E-L-S-A-S-S-E-R.
Okay, and your address?
11 Cherry Street, Selden, New York, 11784.
Okay, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do. New Key Expediting. Madam Chair, well, I'd like to present some photos to the board.
All right, let me just tell you, we'll look at these. But they are labeled?
Yes, they are, ma'am. They're complete with, the photos are complete with the addresses of the adjacent properties, and these properties all fall within the 200-foot radius.
All right, I'll let you do that, and then I'll see. Go ahead.
Okay. Madam Chairwoman, the board may look at this as a substantial request. This is a financial hardship for these people. This garage is going to be used for one purpose only, to store basically antique cars. They're paying a fortune now for rental storage places to keep these cars for quite a long time. They could have probably built several garages for what they've paid. At this point in time, as you notice the photos that I have submitted to the board, most of these structures that are through there are all in that buffer, and some of them right on the property line itself. This thing will not be used for auto repair services. This is strictly for storage. And I don't believe it will have an adverse impact on the area. And if you can look at there, there's a boat storage right down the road from there, right across the street. There's a funeral home also across the street from there. And if the board approves this application, it will be very tastefully done and actually an asset to the community for how it looks.
Well, go ahead. Are you finished?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Let me just tell you. Mm-hmm. Number one, 1,200 square foot detached garage, garage is very substantial.
Yeah.
Very. The other thing is, you're going to the residence district to zero.
Yeah.
There's no way to get behind this garage to maintain it at all. And it certainly is not in the character of the neighborhood. I have been in that neighborhood. I live there. This is not within the character of the neighborhood. Now, you're handing some of these pictures up. They're single-car garages.
Madam Chair, may I just address the board?
Sure.
They may be single-car garages. This property here that Celine owns also has a single-car garage there, okay? Like I said to you, at this point in time, there is also a masonry boat storage right over there also. And most of these things here, if you went behind them, they are literally, there's no room behind them in the buffer either, okay, and a lot of these structures here.
But do they have variances to be on the property line?
Madam Chair, I couldn't tell you that for a fact if they do. But when I tell you that I don't feel it's out of character for the area as far as being in that buffer zone, it's really not, because you can drive all down that strip and they're all over the place there in that certain area. And if the board has suggestions on that, we'd be more than happy to listen to them, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Planning?
Madam Chair, the Planning Department looked into this a little bit. We do recommend that the application be denied based on six reasons. First is that the variance would impact the residential property to the rear having the garage against the residential property line. Second, as you mentioned, there would be no way to maintain the back of the garage without going onto the neighbor's property. Third is the garage is so large that the westerly door is actually blocked by the house and couldn't be accessed with a vehicle. Fourth, it appears that the applicant has alternatives not requiring a variance. A three-bay, 750-square-foot garage could be built with a 10-foot setback from the residence zone and a 3-foot side yard setback. And 750 square feet is larger than typical two-car garages in residential properties. Number five, any difficulty in complying with the ordinance appears to be self-created in that the requirements go back to 1985, and according to the assessor's office, the property was purchased in 1990. Mm-hmm. So if someone purchased the property with the intent to use it in a manner that's not permitted, in essence, they've created their own hardship. Yeah, lastly, it appears that the grant of variance in this situation would tend to set an undesirable precedent. In looking at aerial photographs, there are about 10 properties on the same street that are similar in size and shape. Also, there are about another 10 properties within around a 3-block radius in the same zoning district of a similar size and shape. And we're concerned that if the board approves this one, it may be compelled to approve any others that come in.
Thank you. Can I just make a comment?
You certainly can.
When you say when this property was purchased, this was the purchaser way back then, and the intent wasn't to do this at that time until it started getting expensive to pay for storage for these vehicles. And now we are 24 years later. That's why now we're coming before the board, okay, with this here. It's not something that it was purchased then with the intent of doing it way back then.
Yeah.
Sure. But what I meant was is that it wasn't like the town created the hardship
by coming up with
the rule after they purchased the property, mm-hmm. or that a neighbor created the hardship
correct.
By doing something obnoxious with their own property. That's all.
Well, what I would like the board to consider, and you're basically, if we had revised this a bit up to 750 square feet, and with the proper setbacks, you would put your recommendations out, and we would be more than happy to look at them too.
Sure.
Can I ask a question?
Okay.
Yes, sir.
How many cars does your client have?
You're basically looking at it would be 3 cars, I believe, and a motorcycle. 3 cars and a motorcycle, yeah.
You can definitely get them in there.
Yeah. He probably would have to go back and go get another denial.
Well,
no.
Oh, unless you think
no.
If he does this, will they meet the
Recommendation we made, in all honesty, you know, it is to deny. I apologize, but it is to deny. But it does allow for a 750-square-foot garage, you know, whether it's 25 by 30 or 22 by 33 or whatever the number is. It's wide enough for 3 garage bays plus room in the back and some room on the sides. I mean, it'd probably be best to have one large garage door, because if you have 3 smaller doors, it's tougher. You know, if you had 3 8, 9, or 10-foot doors, obviously 10 wouldn't work, but but it would be enough. These residential property owners often do this in order basically to avoid a variance. They come in with 750 square feet. You never see them. They get a building permit.
Right.
In this situation, if the board denied it, they would be entitled to do that, and they would need probably a site plan exemption approval to do it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right, so then by right, you'll be able to do that 750 square foot.
Correct. And your recommendation, sir, we'll be able to obtain in writing from you?
Sure.
Exactly, to the T of what you're looking for, that the board will actually approve?
Well, our recommendation to the board, surely, there's a sketch in the file that we did. We'll supply that to you.
Okay.
If the board goes along with our recommendation, they may not. So.
Okay.
Well, and you can have it even if they don't go along with our recommendation.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Have a good evening.
You're very welcome. Thank you. Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Rarely moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carried.
The next case is 17,130. PJ Venture, 15 Windanch Boulevard, Smithtown, New York. Location, southeast corner of Crooked Hill Road and Henry Street, Commack. Property zoned SCB. The request is a variance to reduce the drive aisle width from 24 feet to 11 feet for a proposed 631 square foot freezer.
Do you have everything you need?
Yes.
Good evening, John Baker.
PJ Venture?
Yes. Mm-hmm. We can do this ourselves. Yeah. I think we need what? This is
the old sign?
No, I don't believe so. This is the one, the revised one? Is this the revised one? Are we at, this is the one we're looking at? Tony Roma thing?
As far as I know, yes.
Yeah, I guess it was revised in April of 2014,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. I think we're going to need this. Do you have any more of these?
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead. All right. I didn't know I could look at this one. Oh, you have one? Okay.
There's more.
Okay. Good. Okay. Good. Good. Yeah. Give me your name and address, John.
John Baker, 15 Windanch Boulevard, Smithtown, New York.
Okay. Raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
The application before you tonight is to reduce an aisleway as shown on those drawings to accommodate a 631 square foot freezer behind a new proposed restaurant that we have.
Let me see it. Yeah, I think it's only in one corner, isn't it? It's only in one corner, am I correct?
No, it's just a
drive-off. Is it
drive-off? Yeah. This is coming out from the
Okay. Oh, I see. They took the parking out of there. Planning?
The planning department actually recommends approval on this. It basically is a reduction of 4 parking stalls out of approximately 2,600.
Okay.
It's really minimal. I can't imagine that this would create any impacts on any adjacent properties.
Okay. Well, any gentlemen, anything?
No question.
Okay. Thank you. Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Okay. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Regularly moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The next case is 17131 Woodvale Properties, 47 Woodvale Avenue, Kings Park, New York. Location, east side of Woodvale Avenue, 130 feet north of Highland Place, Kings Park. Property zoned R10. Variance to increase the height of a dwelling from 2.5 to 3 stories, to increase the maximum floor area ratio from 25% to 40%. Variance to permit structures within 10 feet of environmentally sensitive lands, that is, slopes with an excess of 15%. Variance to expand a non-conforming structure, to reduce the minimum side yard on the south from 12 feet to 3 feet existing, to reduce the side yard on the north from 12 feet to 10 feet, to reduce the total side yards from 28 feet to 13 feet, for a 1,085-square-foot first-floor addition, a 1,085-square-foot second-story addition, a 1,302-square-foot third-floor addition, and a 600-square-foot attached garage to an existing 910-square-foot dwelling, to increase the maximum permitted paving in the front yard from 25% to 60%, to reduce the minimum setback of paving from 1 foot to 0 feet, to reduce the minimum setback of a retaining wall from 3 feet to 0 feet in the front yard existing, to increase the height of a fence from 6 feet to 8 feet in the rear and side yard.
Donald King, 75 East Main Street, Kings Park, New York, excuse me. If you look at the survey of this property, you'll note that the dwellings on either side have very small side yards. One has 7-foot side yard, the other has about a 10- and 8-foot side yard. I received one call on this from the owner of the property to the right rear, Judge Dunn. He told me he's in favor of it. The variances sound like a lot, but if you look at this from the perspective of the size of the lot, the 3-foot side yard is already existing, and to do this expansion, we need the variances. With respect to the floor area ratio, I did not bring with me the 20 or 30 cases that I got from this board increasing the floor area ratio from 25 up to 54%. I certainly have a significant number in the 40 percentile, and the 50 percentile up to 54%, so that sets a precedent for this. The other thing is, because of the environmentally sensitive land, we had to take out a certain portion of this because of the slopes. You can't count that. Certainly, this will not produce an undesirable change in the proposed character of the neighborhood if you look at the houses. We can't achieve this by any other matter. My client builds beautiful homes. He needs this to construct this house. The variances, I don't think, are substantial if you look at the neighborhood. I don't think it'll have an adverse effect on the environment, and it's not self-created because we're here asking for it. We have 482 square feet. You need 10,000. We have 50-foot road frontage, you need 40 feet. Front yard requirements, 40 feet. We have 85 feet. The rear yard requirement is 50. We have 84. The required side yard, 12. We're going to provide 10 and 3 with the 3 already existing. With respect to the, I asked Dave before the meeting whether gravel counts towards the driveway or the percentage in the front yard, and he said it does. I don't understand why, because it's not impervious, but in any event, it does count. And if you look at the front portion of the survey, the neighbor's driveway encroaches a bit. That will be coming out. I think that's approximately 404 or 440 square feet. Thank you.
Okay. What do you calculate as the square footage of this house?
5,388 square feet.
5,388 square feet.
Yes.
Okay.
We have to, and that's to arrive at the FAR, we had to kick down the square footage from 14,582 square feet to 13,561 square feet because of the environmentally sensitive land.
Okay. I will tell you that I went to this property yesterday to look at the character of the neighborhood. I don't believe I saw one house on that road that is over 2,500 square feet as far as house is concerned. You're telling me that a 5,000 square foot house is not substantial?
No, I'm telling you, that's what I'm telling you.
Okay.
I don't think so. If you look at the lots, I don't think this is substantial because it's a deep lot. If you look at the houses, the house to the right is only 8 feet away from the property line. The house to the left is only 7 feet away. So I don't know how this is going to adversely impact anybody. And as I indicated, the neighbor to the rear said he's for it. I don't know if there's anybody here opposed.
Okay.
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 Can I ask a question?
Sure.
The FARs that you cited before, going from 34 to 50%, were they all in R10 zones?
What I'll do is I'd like to submit them to the board. I'll send them all over. I have them running from, I can't tell you that off the top of my head. Okay. But I believe a majority of them were R10s. Right. And I got up to 54%.
Yeah, but a lot of times when you bring these in, Don, you're not comparing facts to facts. I mean, lots of times it's a very small lot when you give them 54%. They're not 5,000 square foot homes.
Well, you're saying that you don't even know what I submitted or what
okay.
I got.
Well,
how could you say that? I haven't put them in yet. I'd like to mail them into the board. And to
planning?
Madam Chair, just to reiterate some of the facts, the applicant is asking for a three-story home, and the code clearly states that you are allowed 2.5 stories. So going up another half story to be 3 full livable stories is a substantial increase in the height of the home. The FAR, without the environmentally sensitive land being factored out of the lot area, you still have a floor area ratio of 37%. For this proposed house. As you mentioned yesterday during the site inspection, approximately nearly every home on that block, the average size of those homes ranges between 2,500 square feet to 3,000 square feet. This house is nearly 5,400 square feet, which is a substantial increase in the size of the house in comparison to the other homes in the neighborhood. Certainly not lastly, but also very importantly, is that side yard setback. For a single story home, a 3-foot side yard is a substantial reduction for a side yard. For a 3-story home, 3 feet from the lot line, that is a significant impact on the next door neighbor. These are the things that the planning department would like the board to take into consideration when reviewing the application.
Okay, thank you. Gentlemen, any questions?
No questions.
Thank you.
All right, if you would line up, if you would like to be heard on this application, if you line up, please, I'll listen to you. I'm going to ask you your name, and I'm going to ask you to spell your last name.
Hello, my name is Joseph Jandura, J-A-N-D-U-R-A. I live at 24 Oak Hill Lane, Kings Park, New York.
Okay, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay.
In addition to Judge Dunn living on the back borderline of this property, I also live on the back borderline of this property. Two-thirds of the property border with John Dunn, or Judge Dunn, and one-third is along my property line. As you pointed out, that most of the homes in this area is the Charlotte Oaks area of Kings Park. Are 25 to 2,700 square foot center hall colonials and W-shaped colonials. And that at that time they were built, they were considered very large homes. This house, they're putting a 1,085 square foot addition to the first floor, a 1,085 foot square foot addition to the second floor, and a 1,302 square foot addition to the third floor. That's 3,472 feet. And they're gonna put, it says 910 foot a 600 square foot garage to an existing 910 foot square foot dwelling. All right, I assume that 910 foot is just the first floor, and I'll tell you, it's only this first floor. So we have another 1,800, I'm sorry, yes, 1,820 feet on top of that, plus the 600 square feet for the garage, for the two-car garage, you're now looking at a 5,892 square foot home. Right, where most of the homes in the area are under under 3,000 square feet. Matter of fact, under 2,700 square feet. To my knowledge, there is no home in the area. There was no home within 3 or 4 miles of this area, unless you want to include the psychiatric center or St. John's that has three stories. It'll definitely impact on the neighborhood. Now, they want to put an 8-foot high fence in the back. Now, is Osama bin Laden moving here? Who needs an 8-foot high fence in the backyard? I think that pretty much has it.
Okay, thank you. Next, please.
Good evening, I'm Linda Jandura of 24 Oak Hill Lane in Kings Park.
All right, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do. My home, we've been there for almost 40 years now. And we have a lovely neighborhood. And the home in the back, I can understand people want to renovate, fix. No problem with that. That's an attribute to the neighborhood. But I find it very offensive to think that we have to have a mega mansion over all the rest of us. That also, what I object to most of all, is to think that they want an 8-foot high fence, whether it be the plastic, whether it be stockade. I don't know what they want to hide behind this. I have split rail fencing, and my neighbor next door to me has chain link fencing. You can see through it. Nobody runs through the neighborhood. We don't have pit bulls or anything like that. And I do, I object to a big giant fence. If I wanted to live in Manhattan or Queens, I guess that's what they shove up at each other. But out here in God's country, I don't think there's a need for a big 8-foot high fence. I don't particularly want to be looking out at this. And that's my thing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very much. Next, please, may I have your name and spell your last name?
Yes, Carla Powers, P-O-W-E-R-S. I live at 25 Woodville Avenue.
Raise the mic for you. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do. I live on the house, the little bitty house, directly on the north side of this lot that we're talking about. And this is their land. I'm not going to tell them how to build their houses, what they're allowed to build, they can build. Obviously, I'm concerned about the size, comparing to the size of our house, but that's, again, not my concern. My major issue is the wall, they had built a retaining wall, I guess about 5 or 6 months ago, right next to our house, where it is directly on their property line. I was there with the surveyors laid the lines, and it's directly on it, to the point now where I can't even put a lawnmower through my property and their retaining wall that they had to build up. The front as well, there's a property line in the front for the town where the electrical pole is, and they went, I think, 3 feet beyond that. So now, if I don't know if you went by the house, but if you looked at the front, it's like this, and then there's ours. So now it's about 3 feet further out than ours. So now even when the snow plows came, everything just got pushed right in front of our house. We had to go in there and shovel in the front because they can't get in front of our house anymore. And I know they are on state property or town property on the road part. That was my main concern. I mean, obviously, you know, the size of the house, it would be nice if they were smaller, but I'm not going to tell them or you how to build your houses, but that is our concern. I don't know if they built it on the property line, so I didn't know if they had to go back a certain amount of feet, or it just seemed a little close to us, was all my concern.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
And just in looking at the survey, I think it's inaccurate. I don't think it depicts the deck on the back. And if that's correct, then what would be built would look somewhat worse from the neighbor's point of view than the proposed survey indicates. Also, just in doing calculations on the survey here, the proposed house would be approximately 2 to 4 times larger than the two closest houses to the property.
Anything else?
No, thanks.
Gentlemen, anything else?
No.
Mr. King?
Osama bin Laden's not moving into the house. I live in San Remo, and there are a lot, very large houses on very small lots down there. My neighbors have them. I appreciate them because I think they enhance the value of my house. I understand their concerns. I'm not poo-pooing them. They have a right to speak. But from my perspective, in San Remo, when my neighbors have built these larger homes, it certainly enhanced the value of my house. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved. Second.
And regularly moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carried.
The next case is 17,132. Salvatore Coppola, or Coppola, 29 Arrowwood Drive, St. James, New York. Location, west side of Arrowwood Drive, 739 feet south of Elderwood Drive North, St. James. Property zoned R43. Request variance to reduce minimum side yard setback from 24 feet to 8 feet and total side yards from 60 feet to 47 feet for an existing 144 square foot gazebo.
Good evening, Madam Chairman, members of the board. My name is Vincent Tremarco. I represent the applicant. You have before you pictures of the gazebo. Also, I'm sure that some of you visited the site. as the board well knows, when you measure front yards and rear yards, you measure from the front property line back to get the, I believe it's 60 feet in an R43, and you measure from the back property line forward to get the rear yard, which I believe is 100 feet. The gazebo is not within either the rear yard or the front yard, but it is in the side yard because that's the way the ordinance reads. You know, if this were a smaller lot or a different zoning district, it might be looked at differently. Also, if you look at the survey, the people most affected would be on the north side of the property, and the gazebo is well down the property line from the Murphy household. The request might seem substantial, but it really isn't. If it were in the rear yard, I believe it would only be a request for a 2-foot variance in an R43. We don't think it has an adverse effect on the character of the area. Could the benefit be sought by some other means? Yeah, I guess we could move the gazebo, but it really isn't hurting anybody. Whether the area variance is substantial, it's really not substantial because it's really a side yard, even though our ordinance says it's still, I mean, it's really in the rear yard, even though our ordinance says it's in the way the setbacks are set up so that it becomes a side yard variance. Whether the proposed variance has any environmental effect, it's a gazebo, it has no plumbing in it, and it's merely used for sitting in the summer and spring and fall nights and enjoying and looking at the swimming pool, which is towards the back of the property. Whether the difficulty was self-created, well, what happened here is when you buy these gazebos, they're all done. They're not built on the property. They're delivered by some sort of a trailer. It drives onto the property, and the gazebo was set. I believe my client tried to maintain proper side yard for an accessory structure, but he was really in between the side yard of an ordinance requirement. I don't know if I'm making myself clear, but it's not really a situation where it has any effect on anybody, and we ask the board for its favorable consideration.
Okay. Just let me say, I visited the site yesterday. I could not see from the street. I could not see the gazebo, and I think on the side of it, for the where the neighbors are, I don't believe they can see it either with right. All the trees there. That's just my observation. Planning?
No comments.
Gentlemen?
Thanks, sir.
Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Verity moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carried.
Madam Chair, the next case, number 17133, Stamatis Pitas, 9 Beaujour Court, Neskonset. The location of the property is the north side of Beaujour Court, 431 feet east of Lake Avenue. The property is zoned R15. The applicant is requesting a variance to increase the front yard paving from 25% to 49%, which is existing, increase the side yard paving from 25% to 37%, existing, and reduce the setback from any lot line from 1 foot to 0 for paving that is existing.
Okay, may I have your name, please?
Sabrina Pitas.
And your address?
9 Beaujol Court.
Okay. Raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm requesting a variance to increase the front yard paving from 25% to 49%, to increase side yard paving from 25% to 37%, and to decrease the setback from any lot line from 1 foot to 0 feet for paving. As you can see, it's already existing. It didn't affect the environment at all. It's a circular driveway. I think they look nice. There's other houses in the neighborhood that have circular driveways. It doesn't have an adverse effect on the neighborhood. That's it.
Okay. Planning?
Madam Chair, as you're aware, we did do a site inspection of this property. And there was a question raised regarding what is allowed by the code regarding a circular driveway in the required front yard. I did do some research, and in the code, in the zoning ordinance under section 322.12(i)(8), you are allowed to have in any zoning district in the required front yard up to a 12-foot wide circular driveway. Not necessarily by default, but it can be increased up to 12 feet in width to accommodate a circular driveway in your front yard. In the applicant's case, I just did some quick measurements based on the existing driveway she has, and it's approximately 120 feet from curb cut going around the semicircle. At 120 feet at 12 feet wide, the applicant would be allowed to have paving of approximately 1,440 square feet. Currently, what is existing on the site is approximately 2,205 square feet. So the applicant has approximately 765 square feet more paving in her front yard than she would be permitted by code to have with the revised code regarding circular driveways. Regarding the paving in the side yard, because they do have a side entry garage, the code does allow an increase in paving in the required side yard up to 50% to accommodate a side entry garage. The applicant currently has 37% paving, so they are under the 50% maximum allowable paving. However, they do have an issue with the setback of the paving from the side lot line, which is at the side lot line with 0 feet, and they are required to have a 1 foot setback for all paving. Planning would certainly recommend that they can maintain the paving in the side yard as long as it's cut back to meet that 1 foot setback from the side yard. However, in the front yard, there would have to be some consideration regarding the amount of excess paving that we have, approximately 765 square feet above what they'd be permitted. There is, if I'm not mistaken, in the file, a sketch that has a highlighted area of
I
the,
have it.
You have it right there. That is what the applicant would be permitted to have by code. Our recommendation perhaps might be to cut back the driveway to reflect something along the lines of that sketch.
You understand what he's saying?
Kind of. Not really.
Your circular driveway is really too wide. You're only allowed to have 12 feet.
Wide, okay.
Wide. And yours is much larger than that, which brings your paving like 765 square feet over.
Okay.
I have to tell you, we were at your home yesterday, and look, I really didn't see circular driveways on your block at all. Very few.
There is one.
There is one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's one.
All right, let us think about it. Gentlemen, you have any questions?
I have a question. When was the driveway built?
I'm not 100% sure. 2010, maybe?
Okay.
A few years ago, we did it.
Okay.
The survey looks older, but I guess not. It's just faded. The survey showing the circular driveway looks older than 4 years.
No, that survey was just done.
Okay.
Because we're doing all that other
construction. I guess it's just a bad copy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Gentlemen, any questions?
No.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Rarely moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Madam Chair, the next case, number 17134, Lark Clark, 129 New York Avenue, Smithtown. The location of the property is the east side of New York Avenue, 122 feet south of Bowers Court. The property is zoned R10. The applicant requests a variance to reduce the minimum side yard setback from 12 to 8 feet, which is existing, for an existing 851 square foot first floor addition and existing 1,076 square foot second floor addition.
May I have your name, please?
My name is Lark Clark.
And your address?
129 New York Avenue in Smithtown.
Okay. Raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do. I'm requesting a variance to reduce the minimum side yard from 12 feet to 8 feet for an existing house. I don't believe there would be an undesirable change to the neighborhood because this condition of the house being where it is has existed for the last 57 years. I don't think the variance is substantial in this case since it is something that has stood and not seemed to bother the neighbor. I don't believe there's been an adverse effect to the environment. I would just like to say that the house belonged to my father, who's passed away, and belongs to my mother, and obviously I'm the daughter. And my father was in the military, and he was big into obeying the law. And I found in his files a letter that he received. He did these renovations to the house in 1957. And in 1958, he consulted a lawyer on Main Street in Smithtown. And the lawyer said, under the circumstances, your house does not violate any of the provisions of the code, and a certificate of completion will be issued to your builder. So I don't believe that my father knew or felt himself to be not in compliance. So, you know, he tried.
How did you get here? Someone?
How did I get here?
Yeah, this has been up. This is all existing, am I correct?
It's all existing, yeah.
So now?
I could not find a CO for the house. And so I went to the building department.
Oh.
And, you know, I had to submit an application, and it was denied because one corner of the house is 8 feet from the fence,
yeah,
instead of 12 feet.
Okay. But she had a CO for the house, right?
That's 13, that's 8.
Dave, are you ready? No. Anybody?
Yes.
Planning?
No comments.
Any problems? Okay. Anyone? Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Did you get a CO in 1957? Yeah, but you had to pay for the variance. Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Really moved in second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Madam Chair, the next case, number 17135, Hillway Mountain Crafters, LLC, 1044 Jericho Turnpike, Smithtown. The location of the property, the south side of Jericho Turnpike, 345 feet east of Wyandanch Boulevard. The property is zoned WSI. The applicant requests a variance to reduce the front yard setback from 50 to 3 feet existing, for a change of use from a tavern to a power equipment shop.
Okay. May I have your name, please?
Wayne Tringali.
And your address?
1044 Jericho Turnpike.
And what's your relationship to this application? Are you
I'm the new owner.
You're the new owner?
Of the building.
Of the building. Okay. Yeah.
T-R-I-N-G-A-L-I.
Okay. Raise your right hand, please. You swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Would you like this gentleman to speak for you?
Yes, at first.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Good evening, Board. First of all, let me just say I'm very excited about this application because we're taking a building that since the early 50s, this building has been a bar. Located in this area. Most recently, it's been, I think it was Cheers. You may remember the Iron Horse Saloon a few years back. A lot of renditions and probably about 5 or 6 different bars in the past 5, 6 years. My client has bought this building, and he is now going to open up a power equipment. He is located currently on Comac Road, 7 Gables Power Equipment, and he is on the Huntington side of Comac, so we're going to welcome him into Smithtown with a new business here. What we're attempting to do is take the exterior stairway that exists currently that goes over the flat roof in the back of what used to be the bar, entering into the second floor of this building. We're going to take that stairway off and remove it completely and build a new interior stairway within the envelope of the building. Now there's a one-story shed-like area on the east side of the building. We're going to increase the height of it and put a stairway up to the second floor for his office. Currently, where he's building a counter on the inside for a sales and leasing counter, this stairway would be located behind that. So it's a perfect location for it. It works perfectly for what he needs it, which is a private office area upstairs. And also where the stairway comes down, there's an exit door currently directly outside. So it gives perfect exiting for the second floor. It's not impacting the area undesirable. In fact, I think it's going to be quite an improvement. As you know, above the hill of this area, there is residential properties above. There's no longer going to be a bar type situation. Now it's going to be a retail 9-to-5 type of situation. The setback that we're asking for, 3 feet, is actually a pre-existing setback that currently is the entranceway to the building that's been there. It's a kind of a box that you'll see on the survey there that comes out. That's not where we're building the stairway. It's over to the east side above the one area. But of course, it triggers the front yard setback. Any questions?
Planning?
No comments.
Gentlemen?
I would just like to introduce my client. He'll tell you about his business for the past 30 years.
Thank you.
Seven Gables has been established. It's a family-owned business since 1932. We've been in the Commack area. This is going to be the fourth location. Okay, and excited to make an eyesore into a good location now and more presentable. Want to be safe for my employees as far as not having to go outside to go upstairs in all different times of weather. And, you know, there won't be, after 5, 6 o'clock, you know, we'll be closed down and there won't be any impact with the neighbors behind. So.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thanks.
Anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Raley moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carried.
Madam Chair, the next case, 17136, Capital One Bank. 2050 Jericho Turnpike, Commack. The location of the property, the south side of Jericho Turnpike, 250 feet east of Walter Court. The property is owned SCB. The applicant requests a variance to increase the number of wall signs from 1 to 3, permit 2 wall signs not to face a public street.
May I have your name, please?
Name's Ricardo Cervini, C-E-R-V-I-N-I.
And your address?
229 Smithtown Boulevard in Esconset, New York.
Okay. I've already sworn you in.
Okay.
Okay.
Basically, Capital One is requesting a variance to maintain the existing signs at this location, consisting of 2 wall signs known as S-2269, located on the east side, and S-2260, located on the west side of the building. They are requesting an approval to increase the number of wall signs from a maximum of 1 sign to 3 signs and to permit both signs to not face a public street in order to increase the visibility of their business due to the nature and characteristic of the property. Capital One believes that if the board should approve this variance application, there will not be any negative impacts to the surrounding properties. Does the board have any questions?
Planning?
No comments?
Yeah,
one comment.
I would recommend that the board be consistent with your decision on the Bank of Smithtown and your earlier decision on this property so as to avoid proliferation of signage. The only thing that I seem to recall from this is that the proposed signs, or perhaps they're existing at this point, but the Capital One signs are about 10% larger than what the board approved on the same building. And I don't think 10%
more than that.
Is How much?
It's more than that.
It's more than 10%?
They're about 28 square feet, and they were approved to 20 square feet.
Oh, okay. My mistake. I thought they were 24. They're 28 square feet. So they're, I guess, 40% larger. Is that correct? Yeah, 40% larger than what the board previously approved.
Right. Let me ask you a question. I don't know. Can I have, if I looked at this yesterday, if they took, because I guess this is considered one sign, if they took some of the this away, would
Excuse
that
me.
Be in compliance? No?
No.
Excuse me, which sign are you talking about?
This one.
That one has a permit.
Okay.
No, that wouldn't help, because it's the quantity of signs and the fact that they don't face streets. It's not the size of the sign. But we know, we understand that the board has granted variances in the past on the Mayfair Shopping Center for both banks, and we're not recommending denial. It's just that we don't think it should get out of hand, you know, that there should be too many signs, or too large and too many signs.
Okay.
What you're saying, it's the Bank of Smithtown, which had 10% more. What is the exact square footage of the Bank of Smithtown?
I looked it up earlier today. I don't recall, but I was actually referring to this bank, this building, which had previously been a couple of banks, one of which I believe was Jamaica Savings. And the board granted a variance on this property, and I thought it was to increase the quantity from 1 to 2, but it might have been to 3. But each sign, I believe, is 20 square feet, and apparently this one's 28.
Yeah, the range amount of 28 square feet to 29 square feet. Due to the nature of the building, you could see that the position of it, that's why they have the two different signs, one on each side, east and west, to provide the exposure for this bank. It seems like a minimal request.
Okay.
But does the board, if they decide not to approve this, I mean, what would be their basis on not approving something like this?
Pardon me?
No, if the board would decide not to approve this application, what would be the basis for them not to approve it?
Well, we'll take into consideration what we have proved in the past.
I think what we look at is trying to be consistent and fair.
Mm-hmm.
If this, we saw the same application twice and came up with two different decisions each time, we'd have to give a reason for that, because we're really not supposed to look at it as if the sign were there. If you would come in and those signs weren't there, we'd say, all right, what did we do last time? We'd probably approve it to something similar to that, so that we don't get the other person coming back saying, well, you approved them to 28. Why can't we go to 28?
Okay. So just out of curiosity, before Capital One was there, how many signs were on the building? Do you know?
Was it two?
I thought it was two.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the board approved two.
I think what's planning is saying is that we have approved from 1 to 3 in the past, but try to be consistent with what we've done when doing that, because you obviously see the need for signs on those other two facades because of the position of that building.
Correct. Well, as you can see, there's two entryways. You know, you have the frontage of Jericho Turnpike, which that particular sign has a permit fronting that street. Then you have two entries coming into the parking lot, and that's the reason why they have one on each side, to provide exposure and to show the people that the bank is, you know, that's Capital One Bank. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Really moved and second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Motion carried.
Madam Chair, the next case, number 17138, Christopher Weiner, 96 Elm Avenue, Smithtown. The location of the property, the west side of Elm Avenue, 210 feet north of Linden Place. The property is zoned R10. The applicant requests a variance to reduce the minimum side yard from 12 feet to 4 feet existing and front yard from 40 feet to 21 feet existing for a proposed 1,017 square foot second floor addition and a proposed 27 square foot portico.
May I have your name, please?
Christopher Weiner.
And your address?
It's 96 Elm Avenue, Smithtown, New York.
Okay, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. You want to tell us why you're here?
In January, we had a house fire, and we're requesting a variance to reduce the side yard from 12 feet to 4 feet. There's 4 feet existing. The front yard from 40 feet to 21 feet is 21 foot existing for a proposed 1,017 square foot second floor addition and a proposed 27 square foot portico. The roof was compromised from the fire, so we had to, we thought it was in our best interest, being that we have a growing family, we're going to add a second floor. All this structure was existing prior to us moving into the house. I don't believe we're causing an undesirable change in the neighborhood. You know, we're not affecting the environment. I don't think it's substantial. There's houses on the block. They're a lot bigger than mine. And I don't think we're going to affect the environment. And it's not self-created. We had a house fire. And we just decided to make an addition while we're out of the house and in an apartment for the last 3-4 months. That's all I got.
Okay. Planning?
Can I ask a question? The 4-foot side yard is very small in comparison to the requirement. And one of the things that the state laws require boards of appeals to do is consider whether or not there are any alternatives that don't need a variance. So the existing home is 4 feet from the neighbor, and it's one story tall, and you want to go up. Would it be feasible to go out instead of up or have the side yard on the second floor bigger than the first?
Directly behind the house is an in-ground swimming pool. And then we do have property line to the side of us. Mm-hmm. But when we were considering the costs of everything, it was a lot more money for us that we don't have to go out and pour a new foundation than it would be to go up. And right now we're dealing with money from insurance companies and the little bit other money that I have to fix the house up. Coming from another town, I wasn't really, I had done some work on my other house in the town of Babylon, and I wasn't really aware of the different laws that they had here. I thought if it was an existing structure, that being that we weren't expanding the footprint of the home, we weren't going to need all of this stuff. But you know, I'm not a builder. So when we gutted the house and we made plans with our architect to go up, we weren't unaware of this. I thought because it was existing, we weren't going to have a problem. But you know, we're just playing with you guys so we can just get moving forward with this thing.
Thank you.
All right, thanks.
Okay.
Am I good?
You're good.
All right.
I don't know if we're going to approve it, but you're good.
No.
Okay. Is there anyone here that would like to be heard on this application? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Second. You're going to move the second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Motion carried. That concludes our hearings for tonight. Thank you so much.